On behalf of Vadhvani Foundation, would like to welcome you all for today's NEN NextGen Masterclass on customer and market identification and also introduce our expert. Siddharth Nair is a researcher and technopreneur trained in biomedical engineering and currently pursuing his doctorate in medical device innovations and sustainability at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He's an active member of various techno-social communities and enjoys sharing his experiences with budding professionals and entrepreneurs. He has worked in various multidisciplinary projects and has won multiple awards and accolades for his efforts as an engineer as well as an entrepreneur. He's also involved as an investment partner at Campus Fund with a mandate to support student entrepreneurs in their exciting journey. He has a diverse research interest with focus on health technologies, robotics, and automobiles. He envisions to solve various socio-economic problems by developing cost-effective and innovative solutions. We will have the session for 40 minutes, post which the session will be open for Q&A for the next 20 minutes. Post the session, you will have more clarity on how to segregate a market. What does niche market mean? Why should entrepreneurs focus on a niche market? Who is your customer? How to identify the right customer and the early adopters? And why is it important to find out what other associated problems your customer is facing? Before I hand over the floor to Siddharth, here are a few reminders for the participants. You will all be on mute, but if you have any questions, please raise your hand on the tool or you can type it in the chat window or the question and answer box. Over to you, Siddharth.
Thank you, Anju. And it's my pleasure to be here, helping you young budding entrepreneurs to get into your journey of entrepreneurship. So I've not created any kind of presentation and trying to teach you what there's there on the internet. So that's not my goal. The whole idea is I'll try to share my experience of doing it, from my startup and how do I go about it. At the same time, I'll give you some tips as we keep going on. So only thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to share my notes as we talk, so that whatever I scribble, you can also see, and probably it could help you in just getting the reminder of it. So I'm just sharing my screen right away, and let's get started into it. And if any kind of questions in between, please feel free to ask. Let's make it interactive rather than it being just one way communication. So guys, as I told, so this particular topic is very critical. So I just made the initial notes for you, the questions that Anju has asked, which we could discuss during this course of 40 minutes. But even before getting into these questions of market and customer and all those things, I wanted to first give you an introduction of two types of product/service, right? There are multiple types, but I'm just going to focus on two types and then get into the customer part of it. So if you see types of products, so you have one type called as technology push. You have technology push products. And in the second hand, you have something like customer need, right? So we have two types of product which we generally work with. Okay, it could be either a technology push product or a customer need that we look at. So when we see technology push product, the definition would be you have created a technology which works for you, and now that technology you basically want to commercialize. So that's technology push product. So many researchers and many people who research on some product, some technology, and then they want to take them forward, those are the people who look at a technology push product. And instead of customer need, the actual word would be market pull, right? So this is the second type of product, which is very critical. So now when I say market pull, that means the product is in demand from the market and you are like now solving that problem. So that is market pull. In general, experts say market pull is a great way to go about it, right? So market pull is market has given you the problem. If you solve it, they are going to adopt it. And thereby in our hard journey of entrepreneurship and business, at least one thing's become very clear, that is who is the customer and whether they will purchase it or not. So that becomes very clear in market pull. However, I've seen in last one decade of my journey as an entrepreneur, it's very rare that really entrepreneurs work on a market pull product. Very, very rare. It does happen, but it's rare. But most of the people that we do go through is technology push. And I believe personally, that may be also one of the major reasons why there's a huge issue with failures in startup. Again, it's my personal opinion. I may not be right in this case. However, now, though we have a scenario where you may end up making a technology push product, that is, you have made a technology and you want to take it into market. So that's, let's say, that is the scenario that we discuss on. And that's where this becomes very critical of identifying customer, market identification becomes very critical in this. When it comes to market pull, this is very simple because, you have got all the input from the market, so you don't have to worry much. It is all in the flow, it gets through it. But when it is technology push, this becomes very critical. How do you know who is your customer? As Anju said, who is your early adopter? And then what market do you talk about? So that's where it becomes very critical. So most of the discussion that we will have today would be on technology push products, okay? Because that's what would actually make more sense given the topic that we are looking at. So when it comes to tech push, which we look at, how do we now find customers, right? First, you need to know who are your customers. So generally, as an engineer or as an Indian mentality that we have, where we look at solutions, right? That's what first thing comes into mind. We, rather than understanding more and more about the problem, we are very quick in thinking solution, which is good and bad, right? Good when we are actually solving a problem, brainstorming. However, bad when it comes to getting product into market, because we have a lot of assumptions over there, right? So that's the first thing. So what you should do according to me, or what I did when I made my product. So I'll take the example of my product throughout the journey so that it becomes easy for you and easy for me to even communicate. So basically, as a startup, we had made a technology called as neuromodulation. And how this worked was, my mom had an issue and I wanted to solve my mom's problem. That was the reason why I started developing the product. So I was working on a technology called as neuromodulation, right? So what happens in neuromodulation is, you will be giving a stimulus and you will be hoping that the signals in your nerves, in your body, gets modulated and solve the problem. So that's what I was trying to work. So what I did is, I did not worry about customer, I did not worry about market, I just worked on the technology, got it right, and it helped my mother. Right, that was the whole idea of neuromodulation. Technology worked really well, and at the end of the day, people started liking. At least my mom got benefited; she was treated. So now, when I saw that there is a success story, that my mom really benefited of it, I thought, okay, it's time that I should take it to the next level and see if I can build a product around it which can help millions of people. That was my intention when I started my first startup, Fiesta Innovation, way back in 2013, right? So when I started to do it, of course, I did not go through this process. None of us would go through this process. So first thing that we generally do is, we have our assumptions, right? This is very important that you have all your assumptions in place, that who are your customers? So this is like you are assuming who are your customers. Right now, when you are assuming who are your customers, you need to basically look at everything. Now, let's say in case of neuromodulation, my thought was, I'm gonna help in pain management, chronic pain management. So that was my thought, that okay, I should be able to solve chronic pain management and people would be pain free. So my first assumption is, my customers would be patients suffering with, let's say, back pain. So I just chose one pain which would be the most common one. So I chose patients suffering with back pain as my customer, right? So that was my first hypothesis or first assumption in the whole journey of the identifying and understanding the customer. Next, what I did is, I again went on further. I tried to see, okay, is patient with back pain only my customer, or are there many more customers that could actually benefit out of this, right? So I thought, okay, patient suffering with arthritis or knee pain can also be my potential customer. Patients suffering with arthritis or knee pain being my customers, right? So now when I went further, I just see, okay, is this the only place where my product can, my technology can work, right? Then I told, no, it could also work in the case of cancer pain, right? Slowly, when I saw my assumption list, it was so big that, you know, basically every part of body got covered. Okay. So that's how we start assuming things. And then we, there is a classic case where when we have this scenario, we think that whole world is our customer, right? And this is a classic rookie mistake that we all make. And even I made during my days when I was working on my first startup. Of course, in my second startup, I learned from my mistake. I didn't do all these things. But in my first startup, I thought I'm gonna solve all of my world's problems with regards to pain, and pain being the center of universe. So that was my assumptions, right? Now, what went wrong in these assumptions? Let's start getting a little bit realistic into it. Now, of course, the technology, if we would have worked out well, could probably support in all these things. That is because there have been proofs that it could work for this. But as a startup, you need to really, really understand that you have very limited resources. I know that you will be telling me that, okay, we can raise investment, we can take money from the VC, we can take money from the private equity, angels, friends and family, so on and so forth. Agreed, you can take it. But however, see, biggest thing that we need to know is when it's too broad, the risk that the investors bring in also increases a lot. Because if there is a issue in one area, the other areas also are not gonna accept your solution, right? That's the biggest risk. So the best thing that you should do is you should just choose one of these area to start with. Look if that area makes sense. If not, get back to the other area and see if that makes sense. If not, get the third area and see if that makes sense. But please don't consider all of it as your customers. You can keep the others that you didn't choose in back burner. You may work on it in future, but not today, right? So first thing is you need to find out which one you are gonna work. Now let's take a case where I'm first choosing back pain, right? So these were my assumptions that, okay, these all are my customer, whole world is my customer. Now from that whole world being customer, I chose that, okay, let me just focus on back pain. Now when I came to back pain, the biggest problem was there are different types of back pain, right? So it's not just that, there is one type of back pain. So I found out that there are back pain due to spondylosis. Again, I'm just taking big medical words. So please ignore. If you don't know, it's okay. You can always Google search as well. Or there could be a back pain due to disc failure, right? Disc rupture or failure, or all those issues. Or it could be due to accident, it could be due to bad posture, anything. So there are so many reasons why you can have a back pain. So you can just keep taking why you had a back pain. So now, again, I could actually make the whole assumption that I will solve all of back pain together. But seriously speaking, it is very difficult to solve all the back pains together for a very simple reason. The reasons of each kind of back pain is different. Your technology may work in all types of back pain, but it is very difficult for you to prove that it is going to work in all type of it. And for the sake of proving, you will need a lot of money to do it. It's called as clinical validation, right? Basically, you will go bankrupt in that stage itself. So again, it would be as a rookie mistake, we would do the same thing. We would take a whole back pain and then we would probably develop a solution which could work for any kind of back pain. And then when we go to the market and talk to doctors, doctors will say, I don't believe you. I want a proof. And then you would have again got stuck. So now what do we do, right? So now let's, we do, so out of a very big a case, we took one case, which is back pain, but it seems that back pain also is a very big scenario, right? And if we go, people are gonna not, you know, accept you easily. And it would be very difficult journey for you to, you know, get them on board to your thoughts. So now what you should be doing? That's the biggest question that you, that is next that you need to ask yourself. So easy part would be, I try to figure out as a secondary research through internet research and find. So I'll look at an internet search, and in internet search, I will try to find the number of people suffering with back pain, number of people suffering with back pain due to, let's say, spondylosis. So basically, let's say you will be getting a number in any all the cases. Let's say because of, you know, disc failure, let's say about 10 million people suffer. Let's say spondylosis, about 20 million people. Again, I'm just taking a random number. It's not from the study. From due to accident, let's say some people are facing. Due to bad posture, let's say a lot of people are facing. So basically, we get a number. Now, one way, as an initial case, we could, you know, kind of rely on this number to an extent. Just see to it that your source is just not Wikipedia or one random website or one random blog, but it is an official source. So your search source should be from, let's say, official number. Search source should be official. Let's say, for example, there could be a number from Association of Orthopedics or something like that. So should be from an official source or from a government database, something which is very official and people can trust on how the numbers have come, right? Not from a random blog which tells this is the number. That's the wrong way to go for it. So now when you see that, let's say you find out, okay, spondylosis looks interesting. There are so many number of people who are facing spondylosis, and I'm sure my technology is gonna help, right? So you can probably think on that, right? So let's say you do that, and for now, let's say as a first case, you choose spondylosis. Or let's say back posture, because that because of bad posture, many people suffer. So let's say you are looking at a case of bad posture. Now what would happen when you look at bad posture, right? So again, internet has told that so many million people have, you know, bad posture, and thereby they have pain, which affects their, you know, life, economics, blah, blah, blah. So you have now come to a conclusion that, okay, due to bad posture, a lot of things can happen, and, you know, that could actually lead to a problem, right? So now what do we do? How do we figure out if it is the right market or not, right? That's where people will say, go and talk to your customer. I know it's very difficult job. It is a pain to go and ask about your technology to someone else and try to make them understand, or you trying to understand what are their problems, right? However, this is a very critical step, right? And mentors keep talking about go talk to your customer, but real life customers will not respond. And there are so many other reasons that can happen. And, you know, they would be not ready to tell about their problems due to, let's say, some kind of social stigma, or it could be because they don't have time, or that's not really a problem for them, right? There are so many reasons customers with bad posture or patients with bad posture may not, give you a direct data. So thereby, but still you need to do it. Otherwise, you may end up making a wrong, you may end up choosing a wrong market. And thereby, you know, kind of wasting all your efforts, right? So how do we go about this? How do we go and talk to such customers? So here the solution is simple. There are a couple of strategies that you can apply while doing so. One, you know, instead of asking them a question, you go to a clinic, or go to somewhere where there are people with back pain, or go to before we do that, let's say you define the occupations in which they may have bad posture. So one of the classic is, we say all the people working with ITES, that is, you know, working with various software companies, due to their sedentary lifestyle may have a bad posture. And since they keep sitting and working, they may be having pain. So let's say that is our first target, ki these people may have back pain due to bad posture. Next, let's say you tell that marketing people may have bad posture, given that they are traveling a lot using their two wheelers, etc., and thereby they have bad posture and they may be having pain and thereby affecting their lifestyle, right? So marketing is an occupation. So now how will you get data from these people telling that is it really a problem and will they try to afford such a problem? So this is where you need to become creative and innovative. Majority of people, including me, during those days would have gone with what? Our classic surveys, right? So so basically when you look at surveys, you will be like sending up a Google form or you'll have a form and you'll try to ask them to fill in. Now, guys, this is a question for all of you, right? How many of you really, I'm sure all of us have filled a survey, but how many of you really fill in a survey after reading each and every point and giving a 100% right answer, right? Rarest of rare case, right? We always try to do that, some of the other pattern. Like, for example, let's say you have 10 questions, A, B, C, D, B, C, B, A, A, B, C, D. Those are the general methods of answering surveys, right? Because no one has time to keep reading and analyze and answer it, right? And that's thereby a startup's effort on survey can get futile. Of course, not everyone does it, but a huge chunk will be people who would actually do that, right? So that's a problem. So thereby, survey may not be really efficient way of talking to your customer and trying to understand your customer. So efficiency is poor, right? So that's the scenario with survey. So now, how will you now have a strategy that you could still talk to your customer? So second thing is, see, we are talking about bad posture, right? So probably, let's say you give them a game. I'm just giving an, off my mind, whatever idea comes, I'm just talking about that. Let's say the next best way to understand whether they have a problem is, you give them a game which requires a steady posture to win it. Like say, for example, let's say a very simple game where you have a glass and you have a ring. So now you need to put the ring onto the glass, a very simple exercise, right? But it is really, really related to postures, because if your posture is wrong or if your way of, your body balance is wrong, it is very difficult to put it or something like that. You can be imaginative and put it. And now when they keep playing, keep a prize for them, like put in like 10 times you win 100 rupees or you win a chocolate or you win a teddy bear, something like that. You don't need to really pay huge money or huge sum to do it. Proper game. Now, while doing so, record it, right? At the same time, keep noticing how are the postures? Are they facing problem? After the game, are they catching up their back, right? Something like that. So this could be another strategy, how you could try to see, is the customer really facing a problem without asking them a single question, do you have a back pain, right? So that could be a reason. Again, I'm telling you, and these things will not require you a lot of money. Only thing that requires you is a little time and you going there. At the same time, given that it's a game, people also become interactive. Now, how will you approach ITITS? Let's say you go to their companies, you have food courts and you ask, you request someone to help you and blah, blah, and get a space and just try to see if they can come and play. That's one of the ways. So there are multiple ways on how you could do it. It's up to you. So as I told you, second option could be game, right? Make them play a game. Third could be you go to a hospital where people are suffering with, where there are many people who are suffering with back pain. And then over there, probably you can have a, there are again multiple ways you can try to understand. So I'll try to list on a couple of ones which probably could be useful for your startup journey. So let's say, for example, one could be a semi-structured interview, right? Where you have some questions prepared, you can ask those questions. And at the same time, during the process, if you think you have new questions, you can ask. So semi-structured interviews are one way. So and then you need to decode the interview, of course. So that's your job to do. It's not easy. Next could be, let's say you take a survey, but as I told you, surveys efficiency are generally very poor. Third that you could do is something that in design world we call as fly in a wall. So when I say fly in a wall, it's basically you stand and just keep observing without trying to intervene in any possible way, right? You just be there and just see what are they doing. Keep noting down the intricate things that they do. It could be as small as picking up a glass, right? And see if they are picking it up with ease. Are they, you know, kind of bending, etc., etc. So fly in a wall is a classic method. Then there is an alternative way called as, you know, in the shoes. So when I say in the shoes, basically you try to be, you know, them for a day. You know, they do the exact same things and then try to see how their life is there so that you will understand the problem. So that's another method that you could do. So these are some methods how you could actually, without asking much questions, try and understand your problem. And then again, there are multiple options like role play and all those things, which are textbook seldom works, but of course they are also a method which you could use to know your customer better, right? And when you do that, this entire exercise, at the end of the exercise, you need to have a reason why you did, right? And the clear reason of this exercise is to come to a conclusion whether this particular population is a customer or not. And there is a classic, another rookie mistake that we make is we ask our customers how much would they pay for this. Okay, and given that we are in India, which is a price sensitive market, it is very rare that you would actually get a right answer for this. They may end up saying 1000 rupees or 500 rupees or 100 rupees or 10,000 rupees, right? It would be a very random number. So it cannot be a direct question and it should not be in the first level of questions at all. It could go in future questions because at the end of the day, you are solving a problem and you are creating a value. So you need to see how you really get that pricing cost right and not during this customer interviews. It's a very wrong strategy that people look at, right? Or you can take pre-orders. Let's say you set up a cost, see if they are buying it as a pre-order. Those are a good strategy. But it's never good to go and ask how much are you willing to pay for this. Of course, we do it because we don't have time or something, but it is a futile exercise you're trying to do just for the sake of doing. So these are some of the methods where you will try to understand who is your customer. Now, for example, after doing all this thing, you say that, okay, guys, probably though the numbers in the secondary research says that spondylitis is a big market, bad posture is a big market and it's a big problem that they have, you may end up telling that, okay, after the survey, after the understanding of the customer game, I think so this is not the right market. You may figure that out. So you should just not give up, but rather go to the next market. Instead of bad posture, probably disc rupture is your market or spondylitis is your market. You have to repeat till you really find out that small area which is actually your market, right? So this is how, guys, we generally need to approach how do you find your right customer. I know it's a pain. It's like, we need to talk a lot. We need to really think out of the box to get the data. But most of the data in this kind of methods will give you real, real, real indication. So that's what is my suggestion to all of you, that consider being innovative during the journey of finding a customer. So as I said, let's say, for example, in interest of time and understanding things further, we decide, let's say, bad posture is the right market, right? And we go ahead and see the next levels of what we do with this, right? Now, let's say bad posture is the market. And now we need to know, how do we go about taking a product further? So before we go forward, if anyone has any questions, you could probably unmute yourself and please ask me. Please feel free to do it, and then I can continue. Probably I'll give you a 1 minute pause before we go forward. Any questions?
So Siddharth, I see somebody has raised their hand. Let me just check. Yeah, Shubham, would you like to say something? Shiva, can you give him access to microphone, please? Shubham Mohanty?
Yeah, given, ma'am.
Okay. Shubham, can you please unmute yourself and, you know, ask any question that you have?
Sir, how can we take the survey of our problem through which means?
Yes, yeah, so Shubham, I guess I was just answering that question. I was trying to describe that. So do you have any specific, see, as I told you, if you are just going with a, you know, survey form and trying to talk to people or just asking them to fill in a form, most of the time, it's not a great method to get data. Or if, let's say, that's the only way out, try to keep your survey questions limited to two or three so that they don't get bored and actually give you the right answers. Shubham, have I answered your question?
Yes, sir.
Have I answered your question or do you have?
No, sir, no. Sir, can you repeat? I can't hear, sir.
Okay, so I was telling you, Shubham, that survey generally I don't feel is the right method to go and talk to customers, though we use it. So basically, ideally, you should avoid using survey as a method. But let's say if that is the only way that you can get data, then you need to figure out just two or three important questions and have a survey only for that two or three questions so that you get the right data. So surveys are good for that, very small and limited data. And see, most of the time, what I have seen is in India, we don't kind of reward anyone who gives a survey. However, and thereby what happens is it's totally based on their interest if they want to really help you or not, right? However, in US and other countries, what I have seen is they give a reward after a survey. It could be, let's say, a $5 Amazon voucher, or it could be some other way of some kind of discount or something. So if you could do something like that in India as well, where if you are attending this survey, you get some money or some kind of rewards, probably people will be more truthful for your survey. Okay, or they may give some time for your survey. So that's what my recommendation for you is. As a first level, don't use it. If you're using it, try and be innovative in how do you really get the right answers.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions?
No, sir. No, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Hi, Tanya.
Sir, if we are providing a value to the customer, then how would we know that we are charging the exact amount?
Right. So that's what I was trying to tell you, right? When you are providing a value to a customer, best way is to try and sell them. See if they are buying it as a pre-order or some method of selling it. That's the best way to understand whether you are really creating a value. And that's where the initial question which Anju had asked, who are your early adopters and who are your customers? So that's a two different category. So be careful about early adopters. Early adopters are someone who will, you know, adopt anything and everything that comes in market as long as they like it, right? So they may give us a wrong signal. So it's always better, you know, before you sell it, try to understand whether the person is an early adopter, which you can easily do by just knowing what all the person owns, right? A small survey to just understand what all he owns or what is his interest. With that, you may come to a good conclusion that, you know, the person is early adopter or not. So interest and hobbies are the best ways to identify a person being an early adopter or not.
Sir, actually, we are conducting survey nowadays. So if we provide three packages according to us and ask them what they will choose, is this a good method to know that we are charging the perfect amount?
Okay, so basically, best way to do is when you're talking to them and selling to them and you want to find out this, it may not be a great idea to ask them directly, because their mind goes into price, right? So they will start calculating, and when they calculate, they often, you know, try to see that how low you can get, and negotiation comes in picture. So best would be, let's say, as I told you, make it as a game. So So I'm just borrowing one of the case study of a management guru, where what he did is he wanted to understand what beverage goes well with vada paos, right? So that was the case that he was looking at. So what the person did is he created a game, and he gave everyone a vada pav to eat. Now for the beverage, when they were asking surveys, people would tell chai, people would tell because it is a hot summer season, they would say, let's say, a Mirinda or a Pepsi or some cold drinks like that. So that was the survey answer. But what this guy did is, okay, let's have a game. Let's give them a vada pav. And after they eat vada pav, so vada pav is a Mumbai dish where you put a bun and there is a potato, this thing which goes inside it, right? So now, after it was a game of a ring where the person had to choose the beverage of the choice by putting in a ring, and wherever the ring falls, they'll be given that beverage free. And during that, it came to an understanding that the most liked beverage with the vada pav was a chai, a tea, right? And not really cold drinks as it was coming in the survey. So you may choose something like that as your method, where you keep these three packages with price tags around it, and give them a game and let them involuntarily play and try and figure out which is the best one. So that's one of the methods you should do it. So you need to be creative. Just asking a question may not really help you a lot. So be careful in that, Tanya.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
I hope I've answered your question and not further, not...
Yes, sir. You answered it perfectly.
Thanks. Any other questions, or shall we go a little further?
Anju, there's a question in the Q&A box. Sukesh is asking, should we do customer survey only in the cities that we are going to launch in, or can we do it all over India?
See, best way is to do, it's a very tricky question to answer. And it's like chicken and egg story. So what comes first? Customer comes first or market comes first? So if you choose your market first, then that market is the right market for you to go for it. But if you have not chosen your market, then you need to explore and then choose your market. So if you have chosen your market, our demographics in which you're going to be there, please have a service in that demographic only. And any future one that would come in next 6 to 12 months. So only restrict yourself over that. But if you have not chosen your market, then you can talk to anyone, and then slowly come down to which market that you want to be at. Ideally, that's a better way to go, where you first figure out who is your customer, understand your customer, make a persona of the customer, and then you get into looking at your initial markets, your primary markets, your secondary markets, tertiary markets, and so on and so forth. Yeah, any other questions?
No, I think that you can. You can move ahead with the rest of the topic.
Sure. Okay. So now, let's say for the want of time, we select the bad posture is the right customer segment to look at. Okay. So now it's about positioning and understanding, which is the right place to be at, and all those things. And that's where you need to also find a lot of other things. So first thing that we all do as a mistake is, again, we do tell that competition is something which we look at separately and all. But in my opinion, you need to do competition even while you are doing your customer service. Why? Because different customers will have different preference. And generally, we all techies have an opinion that we don't have any competition. Okay, that's a general blanket statement that we make, that we don't have a competition. We don't have anything. So now, for example, let's take the case of bad posture. So in case of bad posture, when we are making a device, we think that, okay, this is the only device that could work. There is no competition who does exactly same thing. Agreed. There may be no competition who does the things the way you are doing. Perfect. However, That is not your competitor. Your competitors are people who are solving the same problem that you have identified, right? And that's how you need to start further understanding that competition and try to link that with your customer, right? So now let's say for the case of back pain due to bad posture, who are our competitions, right? Of course, my device is unique, my device is novel, it's patented, it's new, all those things true. Theek hai. But that doesn't mean that I don't have competition. First thing that we do when you have back pain is go for either using sprays. These days you use sprays like Volini, etc. Or you go with balms, right? Or you go with massaging, right? Or you go with a massager. Massaging is like you go to a massage parlor and get massage. And massager is like you have a device which would probably vibrate and you get a massage. Okay. Then you have options like, a good mattress. Right. And these are the options that we have. Okay. Apart from this device that you are making. But generally, when we look at competition, we will say, okay, my device is one of these devices which can do this and no one else can do it. But guys, there are alternatives which solve the same problem. You need to really understand alternatives and you need to start mapping which alternative is preferred by whom in your customer and try to start building a persona around it. Now, for example, this can go in any direction that we want, right? So now let's say we say our customer needs to pay X amount. So now we need to figure out who among this entire demographics that we found would be our customer, right? And why will they really choose our product, right? So now in this case, you need to really understand multiple options. Like for example, probably who can afford your product. You may always have a target price, right? So let's say your product target price is 5,000 rupees, whereas you get a spray for about 70 rupees, right? And a balm for about 30 rupees. But please remember that though the spray and balm cost 70 and 30 rupees respectively, that doesn't mean that that's the cost of it. The cost of the product, the customer pays is basically for the lifetime. So whatever life they are using that product and how much numbers are used, that is the total expense that they make for the solution. So people always tell that, okay, this is just for 70 rupees, I'll buy this. Okay, but if the spray can get over in 3 days, every 3 days you're going to buy a spray can. And let's say you're using it for 1 year, overall your cost would be blah, blah. So that's how people have to, you need to understand the costing. You cannot just see that the cost is this, but you need to understand operationally how much does it cost the customer really. And sometimes the customer may not be aware that he is actually paying way more than what he would have paid for your solution. So you need to make sure that you make them understand the value that you are creating. So now, as I told you, let's say you are looking at cost of your competitors. Second thing that you would choose is, let's say, salary/income bands, right? And then match whether these income bands use these products or something. So again, you can find this out. Best way to find it out is, again, is a game, because it makes interactive, right? So basically you can create a game, put all these competitors and see which one they choose. And thereby you get an idea that they would actually choose a spray or balm over a massager or a good mattress. So like that's how you will try to find more and more. So if you can be very innovative in understanding these linkages and trying to get answers without actually questioning, you are close to the truth, right? Because for example, let's say an employee or a person earns 1 lakh rupees a month. For him, if he says balm, it may be a little ego issue that you are earning 1 lakh rupees and you are going to use, let's say, a tiger balm of 30 rupees, right? So he may tell, instead of balm, telling that I have a very good mattress. Actually, he may not have a good mattress. So these things can happen. So best way is to like find out through such issues where you're not asking questions, but seeing their reflexes and responses and trying to find out what they use and start linking it with, some or the other features or parameters that you have found? Like, for example, as I told you, salaries or income bands, or you can ask for gender. You could look at place of work, you know, which kind of company they are working in, you know, is it a business, what kind of profession they are in. So using all these things, you can actually try to come and figure out, okay, who is actually going to pay for you, right? I know it's very tough. It's very easy for me to say, but trust me, guys, doing this early in your life cycle will really save a lot of pain for you. And secondly, in the investment domain, given that I have some background of investments now, we see something called as product market fit. And in the early stage, investments like the ones that Campus Fund makes, it's very difficult to have an established product market fit. And when there is no established product market fit, we look at how are you trying to achieve product market fit. And that actually goes on to our decision making. It helps us in our decision making, whether you understand product market fit or not, right? So that's the reason why you need to try and understand how you do this competition analysis in this case. So as I told you, this is how probably you will be like kind of going on narrowing down your demographics, and you may come with some number of people who could work. So generally people go with the big numbers, like my total, for example, let's say diabetes, they will say my total addressable market is 77 million people in India, right? But is that your real TAM, right? So that's how you need to really, really, really go down. Generally, we do as a startup all these things. I understand that most of the time because of the time issues that we do this. But if you are serious, you need to really look at these things more closely. And I have done for my startup, at least in the second startup. First startup, I was just like how you guys have done, or the questions that I had raised, like, you know, very generic, very things. And that time, it was way early. I'm talking about 2012-13, when startup ecosystem in India was just like, startup ecosystem support in India was just growing. Startups were already there by then, but yeah. So that's how you need to look at this thing. So now, when you do these steps, how will you look at, there are two things we need to understand, right? One is niche market, and second is your normal markets. So guys, there's always a debate whether we should go for a niche market or whether we should go for a normal market. And it's a very difficult answer, right? And it comes from different school of thoughts. So let me try and address this question in both the ways. In the first scenario, let's take a consideration of having a niche market, right? So when we talk about niche market, basically it's a new product, and a problem may also be new. You have identified the problem and you have given up a new solution which could actually fit into solve the problem beautifully. However, there may be a scenario where people are not aware that's a problem, right? So for example, that's a problem, right? So that's a big problem, right? When people don't know that's a problem for them. For example, if I say, Zoom calls and all this online virtual conferences are there for a while now, right? But people used to always feel that a meeting is better, a physical meeting is better, and Zoom calls and all are not a great alternative. But as soon as the pandemic hits, you know, they started accepting it, right? So, but what problem these things were solving is like inaccessibility, like probably issues with communication, transports, etc., could be solved and the meeting could be wonderfully done. That was the problem they being solved. But people were not aware that that's a problem for them, because for them, they took it as a normal life, right? So even if this niche markets have these kind of small risks that can happen, and thereby they get into different games. Like for example, when Skype came, it was all about talking to friends who are in US, UK, because of, you know, difference, and you need to pay a lot over on your phone calls, etc. And that's why Skype got boomed. So these are the things that they were doing initially. And now when this pandemic came in, now everyone started to use it for meetings. See, I'm giving a virtual seminar today, and so many other things, and thereby so many other features have come into picture. So that's a case of a niche market that could that looks at how you can know people are not aware of the problem, basically. Second is, let's say people are aware of the problem, and there is no good solution, or they don't want to solve it. Now, this market is also a little tricky market, right? So now where competitors don't want to solve it, and people, all of them know that there's a problem. But then you need to understand why they don't want to solve it. This is a very important question when it comes to niche market. Why people don't want to solve the problem? Okay, you need to really understand, because we may see that it's a great opportunity, great problem, great market. You need to really be very clear if there are competitors, why they have not really solved this problem and others have not looked at this problem, right? I'm sure we all think that we are, we all think that we do something very new and everything. But trust me, guys, it's not like one person has that one idea. Anyone and everyone can have different ideas, right? So if they have not solved, there will be a reason for that. So please try to understand that very well before getting into the entry of niche markets. Okay, so be very careful over there and try to analyze why people have not done, what are the problems, see the ecosystem, because these things can become a barrier for your entry, right? Ecosystem is a big thing. You need to understand everyone who is involved in the value chain. Because if you are trying to overpower someone, they will become a barrier for you. So please do look at why people are not trying to solve. It can be even because you know that they can solve this problem, but it may take 1 rupees more. So if that is the case, please understand you need to solve the problem without changing the price bracket. You need to be cheaper or equivalent to the current price and still do better. Then they will accept it. But let's say, for example, if I say of recycled packaging, right? I've been talking to a lot of people about recycled packaging these days. One of the reasons why recycled packaging is not such a hit is because customers have to pay a little extra, right? And when it comes to pay a little extra for the same thing, people generally are not ready. So if you are coming up with a solution which can, go with the current pricings and, current cost, then people will surely accept it, wholeheartedly. If it is even a 1 rupee more than that, it's very difficult to have a scale, because packaging industry, it's all about scale and not one or two customers. So even if you're in a niche market, be very, very careful. That's the reason why many of these bio leathers are not really working, right? Because of course they are they have replaced the normal animal leathers, and we are saving a lot of animal, etc. But however, the cost is very high, and that's why the animal leathers are still in demand. So be very careful in the niche markets. However, all said and done, every product has a market. It's not like you don't have a market. It's only about how big is your market. So no products are actually a failure. You will have a market, but it may be a very small market, which is not big enough for you to actually make good profits out of it. So be careful. And second thing is your regular markets. Regular markets are great because the problem is there, solutions are there, people understand it. Now, only thing that you need to do is understand the flaws of your competitors and you'll be better than them. So that's a very easy market to enter. But however, be careful that if your newness that you bring in is not innovative enough and it can be easily replicated, it's a very difficult ballgame that you're going to play and very difficult to raise investment. So that's the reason why, as I was telling, both have pros and cons. So be very careful. Both are great markets, but you need to really look at it. So I believe we have come down to 7. So Anju, is it possible to go a little more, or it's a hard stop at 7?
So Siddharth, Rajat, this side.
Yeah.
We can go on for maybe 5 more minutes, but we are also hoping that if participants had some more questions, we could accommodate those questions.
Yeah, that's why I was exactly asking. So I'll just give a tick mark and then just go for example, the questions that I had in my mind was how to segregate a market, which I believe I have given an indirect answer. Niche market, yes. Why should entrepreneurs focus on a niche market? So as I told you, niche markets are new market, and if you can really make a change and you are the first mover, you will have a first mover advantage. However, be very cautious while you are entering it, and you need to know why others have not solved it, right? And be price sensitive. Don't think that just because you're adding value, people are going to pay for you. No, you need to be very, very, very careful in these kind of niche markets. Yeah, I believe most of the questions I have answered. So let's open for question answers and see if you have any questions, and then after that, wrap it up.
Sure, Siddharth. I'll request all the participants to put up their questions in the Q&A box. And we'll have another 5 minutes of Q&A. If you have any questions, please go ahead. This is your chance. Guys, any questions, please put up in the Q&A box. You guys can ask your idea-specific questions, guys. This is your chance to, you know, get these answers from an expert. The question, if the competitor solves the same problem, then what will be the consequences?
It's actually good if you have a competitor who solves the same problem. So you know what is not working for them, right? So you need to start understanding your competitor. Don't take them as a competition, but take them as a peer who has done it earlier. Thereby you get a chance to understand what didn't work for them, right? Or what works for them. So if you have competition is good. That's what I would say. In fact, if you have competition, people will be more and more interested in you, because if you are giving an alternative which is better and which is defendable, right? Nothing better than that. So if you look at examples right from Facebook, when Facebook came in, you already had Orkut and MySpace, right? And Facebook was a competitor, but Facebook won. No? They were hands-on out of it, right? So competition is good. You just need to understand what works for them and what doesn't work for them. And you need to have something which gives you an edge over others and not easily replicable / copyable. That's the only thing that you should look at.
Sure. Gunjan has a question about what is the best way to try to calculate the TAM, SAM, and SOM, the total available market, serviceable available market, and serviceable obtainable market.
Okay, so Gunjan, it's a kind of very specific question. So best way is always bottoms up. So basically you go in the market and try to start understanding it one by one and start. So as I told you, the whole journey of how to find your customer, every place you are actually narrowing down, right? So that will give you a best idea of what's your obtainable market, right? And which is the segment. So that's the best way to find out. Irrespective of that, we can always use available published surveys and data to understand, you know, your segment and give a SAM, SOM, and TAM. But best way is to go there and try to follow whatever I spoke today. And that would give you a good idea of SAM and SOM. TAM is always there. So that's, I'm sure you will, that we all know how to get into.
So next question is from Subhajit, who's asking, how far collaborations with organizations work in a niche segmented market at the beginning? Is it a good option?
Of course, it is a very good option, because collaboration can help you in accelerating your journey and reaching there quickly. However, be very careful on, of course, your IP one and all the kind of agreements that is required. But apart from that, the bigger thing that you need to be very, very careful when you look at collaborations in early stage is that what is in it for them, right? It should not be that they are just your vendor. Collaborators should be your collaborators, where you both are going to benefit in the future. So it's a very, very important thing that you need to have collaborators and supporters. But at the same time, you need to also have a defined giveaways and takeaways out of it. So that's the only key way towards a good collaboration.
Right. So next question is from Kaushal, who's asking, if the service is free to use, then how to know whether it will succeed or not by a survey? If the service is free to use, how to know by a survey whether it will succeed or not?
Okay, so basically, of course, one of the ways you need to see how your pattern of answers are. That pattern of answers will give you a good idea whether it's a random pick or, you know, it's been thought through. Second is number of minutes taken for answering the survey could give you an indication. Third is there is a whole method of in psychology, how you ask questions in different methods and then try to understand how the person is responding. So if those methods, if it is not matching, sometimes you can get a good link that they have not answered it well and things like that. These are some of the methods on how you can validate whether your survey was successful or not with free. But then again, it requires a lot of efforts and a lot of understanding on behavioral psychology to really get there. So that's the reason why surveys become tricky.
No, I think what he meant was if the service that they're trying to provide, service being offered, the service is free, then how to understand by a survey whether it will succeed or not? Service is free, right. some free service is being provided. So how do you identify through a survey whether it will succeed or not?
Right. If the service is free, again, there are a lot of free things. Point is, the biggest point in free apps or free services, how often they come back and use it, right? So when you're doing a survey also, if you are just taking a survey after one or two use, it may not really help to understand whether it will be successful or not. So let's say, for example, you have, if you're using survey method to see if it is succeeding or not and the service is free, then you need to see how often they will reply to your surveys. So let's say you need to have multiple surveys in a kind of a defined or a frequent gaps, frequency you can define, and see if they are able to answer those surveys after using the service. And if they are continuously interacting in the platform and still answering your service, there's a good chance that it could succeed. So you need to have those kind of metrics that thought through and see. Again, this is just one method. There can be multiple methods as well, but this is one of the methods where you can do it.
Sure. What if the product is complicated to build? Very generic question, but
I don't know. So in my field, most of the products are complicated to build, given that it is medical. So best way to do is you will not have all the skills to build it. So best thing over there is collaboration. You need to really find right collaborators who can help you in your journey and build it quickly. So that's the best way. But if those are your constraints, it's better not to venture into such products.
And there's a question by Dharmil, who's asking, sir, I'm looking to explore the market space for creating financial awareness or financial education to the students studying between 5th to 12th standards. How to evaluate the market?
Okay. So basically, this is a very difficult thing to really look at because you're talking about students who may not even have awareness of what you're talking about when you look at finances. So best way, I really don't have an answer, specific answer for this question, because who will be your customer becomes a very questionable thing. Is it a free service or is it a paid service? If it is free service, your approach to this thing will be different. For example, if it is free service, you can just go to schools and kind of make schools your customers and give that tool to the students, and through the school curriculum or the value added curriculum, make it happen. If it is a paid service, then it depends on how much you're charging and what's the strategy to do it, and what is it in it for them to get into this financial tool. So it becomes tricky with just this question. I need more details to think on it, but as a very generic answer, if it is free, the pathway is very clear. Go to schools, show them the value, and that will help them to take it forward. If it is paid, then we need to have a lot more answers before I tell you some other methods to do.
Sure. So I think that's all, Siddharth. I think that's all the questions that had come in. I, on behalf of the foundation, express a lot of gratitude that you could take out time to join us and share your insights and learnings with these participants. So thank you so much. We are really grateful, and we hope that we continue this association and we can have much more learning from you going further in the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Siddharth.
Thank you so much. Please do share the feedback how it was, so that I could improve my interaction in the coming session.
Sure.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. Sure. Thank you, everyone. Have a great
guys, day. Please share the feedback on the session on the link shared in the chat. Make sure you share your thoughts so that we can keep on making these sessions better and better going forward. So I've shared a link in the chat. Please share your feedback on the link. Everyone, request you to do that. Thank you so much.
Bye.